and once they will be signed out also, because if the internet connection is slow or lagging, they are automatically going to be logged out. So it will take some time for them to come back into the waiting room and then come into the chat. So see to it that the internet connection is consistent throughout the meeting.
Okay, sir.
Just search for Dr. Peter. He must be there in the meeting.
Sir is not there yet. Sir, just
we'll be starting in 2 or 3 minutes.
Yes.
You may just remind me when it is 9:45. Sorry, 8:45.
Yes, yes. 8:45. Sure.
Good evening, sir.
Yeah. Good evening, everyone.
Should we start?
Good evening. Yeah, please start.
So, good evening, everyone. Today we are having our continuation of BOA lecture series for PGs, and today there will be a lecture on diabetic retinal detachment by Dr. Swapnesh Sawant, sir. He is also our secretary of Bombay Ophthalmic Association, and he is one of the brains behind starting this lecture series. And the moderator will be Dr. Pritam Sawant, sir. Sir is being my PG guide, my mentor throughout my residency, and he is also the president of BOA this year. I welcome both of you, sir.
Yeah, thank you, Sumit. Now, I'm sure you've listened to the seminars last 2 or 3 which we had. Today's topic is interesting, but you know, there can be a lot of questions and doubts in this topic. So probably what we can do is there is a chat window, and if you have any doubts, you can probably put up in those chat windows. And while Swapnesh is giving the lecture, if some doubts are pertaining to a point he has made, probably we can solve those doubts at that same time rather than waiting till the end. So Sumit, you and me, we will keep a watch on the chat. And because Swapnesh will be busy in describing the thing, so we'll keep a watch on the chat. If we feel there is a pertinent doubt, then we will stop Swapnesh so that he can clear that doubt and then proceed. Is that good?
Yes, sir. Fine with.
So also, if it is a very small doubt, you can answer in the chat itself.
Yeah, yeah.
Perfect. And everybody can read.
Absolutely. Yeah. Start.
Yeah. So welcome, friends. Today's topic is vast, so without much ado, I'll just begin, and I'll try to cover as much of retinal detachment as possible. And thanks to Pritam sir for giving me this opportunity. So our lecture will be divided into retinal detachment pathogenesis, mainly Lipkoff's rule, scleral buckling basics, vitrectomy, and some modern techniques. So going back to the history of retinal detachment, it goes a long way back. Jules Gonin was the first to appreciate the significance and therapeutic effect of closing retinal breaks. So the history is divided into, it's interesting, pre-Gonin era, Gonin era, and post-Gonin era. So before Gonin era, there were all postulations that retinal detachment is because of exudation only. It is because of lack of retina to keep up with the growing sclera. So all these things were put to a stop, where Dr. Gonin decided to put forward his theory that a retinal break has to be associated with a RD, and if there is a RD, you have to search for a retinal break. So that changed the complete treatment protocol. Later on, Custodes developed the concept of scleral buckling implants inside the scleral wall. Skipins, which you can see in the middle photo, refined the scleral buckling technique to the explants and devised the encircling operation. Lipkoff came with the silicone sponge explant as well as cryotherapy. And Robert McCammer is the father of modern vitrectomy, the spectacle guy which you see in the black and white photo. And incidentally, this week we are celebrating 50 years of closed vitrectomy. It was on 20th of April 1970 that we started with the concept of closed vitrectomy. So retinal detachment is a separation of sensory retina from the retinal pigment epithelium due to accumulation of fluid in the potential space between them. It can be classified into rheumatogenous RD, tractional RD, and exudative RD. The etiology of rheumatogenous RD will be most commonly acute PVD, acute posterior vitreous detachment, peripheral vitreous degeneration, myopia, retinoschisis, intraocular surgical complication can lead to an RD, trauma, intraocular infections like ARN, PORN, chorioretinal colobomas, and some hyaloidopathies like Stickler syndrome, Marfan syndrome, and so on and so forth. The etiology for tractional RD, now tractional RD is a RD without any break, is proliferative diabetic retinopathy, vascular occlusions, vasculitis, ROP, FEVR. So any tractional RD can get converted to a rheumatogenous RD in the sense when the traction increases to a larger extent, there can be a break. A break is also called as rheuma. So a tractional RD gets converted to a rheumatogenous RD, and when that happens, it is called as a combined RD because there is a tractional component which is getting converted to a rheumatogenous component. Exudative RDs are different. They are basically caused due to choroidal tumors, VKH, posterior scleritis, CSR, and there is no break which is seen with them. So this is one of the most important differentiations which you may be asked in the exams. Rheumatogenous RD, tractional RD, and exudative. We'll quickly go through it. The cause is, I'll first read about rheumatogenous RD, is a full thickness break. The presentation can be flashes of floaters in 50 to 60% of the time. Patient may see a black shadow in front of them. On slit lamp, you will see a tobacco dust, which is like pigmentations in the anterior vitreous cavity. The configuration of the RD will be convex. You will see corrugations which are there. That means the surface of the retina will have some undulating folds. And there will be movement of this retina with the movement of the eyes. It may be bullous, but it never touches the lens from behind. The retina may be bullous. It may extend up to ora serrata also. Then the SRF origin is usually the liquefied vitreous, and the SRF is clear in the early RDs. There may be a so these are very important points like demarcation line, intraretinal cysts. These two things are always seen in a rheumatogenous RD, never seen in a tractional RD or a exudative RD. And the treatment of rheumatogenous RD would be buckling, pneumatic retinopathy, or vitrectomy, which we'll discuss. So the tractional RD, there will be no tobacco dust. The configuration will be concave because there is a pull from inside the vitreous cavity, which is seen. Appearance is smooth. There are no corrugations, indulations, which are seen. It may not be bullous because there may be a local area of traction. And SRF is not because of the vitreous, because probably there is some kind of a choroidal fluid which is accumulated over there. It's really not clear what is the origin of SRF. And the demarcation line, intraretinal cysts, they are absent. In exudative RD, the pathology is more choroidal. There are no flashes which a patient can see, but there is a definite visual field defect which is noticed by the patient. Again, the configuration is convex, unlike the tractional, which has a concave configuration. Sumit, you can pause me if it is inaudible or if there is something.
No, sir, it's perfect.
Yeah. The SRF is, as I said, originating from choroid or any retinal inflammations, and the nature is shifting. There is a shifting fluid sign which is seen on indirect ophthalmoscopy, also can be picked up on a B scan. So in brief, and no surgery is required, we have to treat the cause of exudative RD in a particular case. Now, total rheumatogenous RD denotes separation of the entire retina. So there are few terminologies which I'm trying to clear you. What is a total reg RD? What is a subtotal reg RD? And what is a subclinical retinal detachment? So total reg RD means the entire retina is detached. Subtotal RD means most of it is detached. So there is an area where some part of the retina is still attached. In a subclinical retinal detachment, there is subretinal fluid which is extending more than 1 disc diameter from a retinal break, but it is less than 2 disc diameters posterior to the equator. So it is a very peripheral area of SRF accumulation around the small retinal break. Now, if a subretinal fluid extends less than 1 disc diameter, the condition is defined as a retinal break only without a detachment. So that should clear most of the terminologies. Now, what are the physiological factors which keep a retina attached? There is a mucopolysaccharide matrix which is present between the photoreceptors and the RPE, which binds both of them. Also, factors like metabolic transfer of iron, the metabolic activity in the RPE and the retina complex, oncotic pressure gradient, and the hydraulic force of the IOP, all these factors play together to keep the retina attached. So what? How does it detach? Now, mostly, again, throughout the course of the lecture, most of the time we are discussing about rheumatogenous RD. So there is a formation of retinal break. If you can see the cursor. So you can see this area where the retina, there is a break, and the liquefied vitreous is gaining access to the subretinal space, and there is where the SRF accumulates. It can happen because of the movement of the vitreous. When there is posterior vitreous detachment, the vitreous body moves and the vitreous is attached firmly around the disc, along the vessels and at the ora serrata. So at any point, it can cause a traction, the retina can chip off, and that gives a potential space for the liquefied vitreous to gain access to the subretinal space, and that is how this SRF is accumulated, and it goes on accumulating more and more as more and more eye movements are there. And there is a system where the RPE can pump this fluid out, but potentially there is so much of fluid that even the RPE, there is a failure of the RPE metabolic systems to take care of this SRF which is getting accumulated. So the treatment of retinal detachment in principle will be either we will displace the eyeball towards the retina, or we will displace the retina towards the eye wall. So it will be either of these two or a combination of these two. How do we achieve it? Is by placing a buckle. So you can see that there is a break over here. And once you place a buckle, the eye wall is coming towards that break to plug that break. You can also drain the SRF fluid via various techniques. Along with all this, you can put a tamponade inside. So here we are talking about buckle plus gas injection, where we are tamponading from inside. We can also release the vitreoretinal traction if it is too much. We are talking about if we can remove all the vitreous, that we can combine a buckle surgery with a vitreous surgery also. And obviously we have to have some kind of a chorioretinal adhesion, which can be because of by doing a cryotherapy, or we can do a laser photocoagulation, either via indirect or a endo laser. That means the instrument going inside the vitreous cavity can do that laser during the vitrectomy. So when the force of vitreous exceeds the adhesive force of the retina, that is a time when the break develops. So as you can see, when the break develops, then there is an equilibrium which is re-established between these two forces, and then the fluid keeps on going behind the retina. So this is what happens when a retinal break happens. Now, how will you approach a case of RD? You have to have a very good preoperative assessment, a detailed history. The patient has to lie down in a supine position. He has to have well-dilated pupils, and you have to master the technique of indirect ophthalmoscopy as well as scleral depression. A very important aspect is how will you draw a fundus diagram? So this is called as an Amsler's chart, which has Plokka's marking on it, 12, 1, 2, you can see the Plokka markings. So you have to draw this fundus diagram, ask the patient to lie in a supine position, and you are standing at the head end of the patient. You are placing the chart in a way that the 12 o'clock on this chart touches the shoulder of the patient. So you are putting the chart just next to him in the orientation where the 12 o'clock is close to the shoulder of the patient. And you are observing the inverted image on the indirect ophthalmoscopy and exactly drawing whatever you are seeing. When you invert this image, automatically it will be correct. So you have to identify PVR locations, lens status of the patient, how much of a conjunctival scarring there is there, because all this pre-op assessment will help you to plan your surgery better. Where are you going to put the cannula, and so on and so forth. Whether there is a presence of a choroidal detachment also, you are going to check during this time. Examination of the other eye is equally important, and the patient and the relative education regarding the surgery schedule, what is the post-operative expectations, all this has to be discussed at this particular time. We usually used to do it in Shankar Nidralaya an evening before the surgery is planned and keep this chart ready for the surgeon. So in the chart, there are three circles which are shown, which essentially show the equator, the ora serrata, and the plas plena or the plas bracketa both together. So there is a color coding which is given in all your textbooks. More important is to label your diagram. So there can be a little bit of variation about how is the paving stone degeneration depicted, what should be the color of the subretinal deposits. So there might be some difference between various textbooks, but you can follow whichever textbook you are reading. But labeling is important because finally the examiner is going to look at what have you labeled it as. Coming to the Lipkoff's rule, it is very important to actually find out where would be the primary break. So the rule one states that in a superiotemporal or superionasal detachment, the primary break is within 1.5 cloacas of the highest border. So look at image 4 and 5. The image is slightly of the duration when the superiotemporal RD has started. It has gone and crossed the midline and then shifted to the other side. But still, if this is the point which is on the higher side of the detached retina, then you will see that the break will lie within 1.5 cloacas of the highest border. If this was the highest border, then it would be mostly lying over here. Rule number two, in total detachment, refer to image 6. In total detachments or superior detachments that cross 12 o'clock meridian, vertically above the disc, the primary break will be at 12 o'clock or within a triangle which is formed by the apex of the ora serrata and the base of the equator extending from 11 to 1 o'clock. So in the sense, it will be very close to 12 o'clock, either this side 1 clock hour or that side 1 clock hour when you have a superior detachment. So this is about image 6. Inferior detachment, refer to image 1. The higher side of the detachment, when you have an inferior detachment, the higher side of the detachment indicates the side of the disc where the primary break lies in. So suppose this is the higher side of the detachment, this side of the optic disc, mostly inferiorly you will find the break on that side itself. So that is your rule number 3. However, if the inferior detachments are equal in size, mostly you will have a break bang at 6 o'clock. And rule number 4, when the inferior detachments are bullous and you have some area of superior retina which is attached, you have to look out for this wedge of a SRF or a track of SRF which is extending in the superior half. And mostly at the top of it, you will see a break near the margin of the attached and the detached retina. So this is to find a primary break. Mind you, the patient may have more breaks, but this gives you an overall idea how to look for a primary break. A primary break is a break because of which the retinal detachment has started. And secondary breaks are breaks which are formed later on. So if you have found out primary break, don't stop. Look out for more breaks if they are there. If they are not there, then it's fine.
Excuse me, Sapnesh sir. Sorry to stop you in between.
Yeah.
PK Mehta sir has just joined the meeting and he's attending the lecture here too. Very warm welcome to you, sir, here.
Thank you very much. Thank you.
Can I continue soon?
Yeah, yes.
Please.
So, how is the decision making in scleral buckle or vitrectomy? This is just a guideline. This is not a fixed protocol. But usually if you have a young patient, he will have a formed vitreous. The vitreous is not going to be that liquefied. If there is a subtotal RD with no PVR, the media is clear, there are limited number of lesions, and most of these patients are going to be faking, then I would err on doing a scleral buckle if the break is depressible. Means if I can access to the break with the scleral depression. If the patient is of old age, mostly the vitreous is going to be liquefied, there is total RD, or if there is total RD with PVR changes, if there is a hazy media, multiple lesions, if it is a case of re-RD, mostly these patients are pseudophakic, then I would err more on the side of vitrectomy. Pneumatic retinopexy is a modification in between where we can offer this to a particular subset of patients. A patient who has a specific rheumatogenous RD, including those with breaks confined to superior 8 clock hours, means a superior RD from say 10 o'clock to 2 o'clock with few breaks, and all the breaks lying within 2 clock hours. So there are only 1 or 2 breaks or 3 breaks which are very small and lying within 2 clock hours of each other. These are the patients where we can offer them a procedure which is called as pneumatic retinopexy. It is also favorable to do these procedures in case of patients who have scarred conjunctiva, who have functioning filtering bridge. So this is minimally invasive procedure, but for these specific RDs only. And there are 2 ways to do it. See, basically, we want to do a cryopexy. That is, we want to close the break with the help of a cryo probe, and then inject a gas inside the vitreous cavity so that that can push, act as a tamponade, and the break can close. Or you can plan a gas injection, wait for 1 or 2 days, and then do a photocoagulation of the breaks using an indirect ophthalmoscope laser. So you have to achieve retinopexy, and you have to push the break from inside towards the eye wall by gas injection. Obviously, there can be a failure rate in this. You have to explain it to the patient that this is a minimally invasive procedure which we are trying to do because your RD is very limited, but you may need a vitrectomy or a buccal after we examine you after 2 or 3 days. So don't promise the patient that everything is going to be fine. This is just a procedure which, if successful, the patient can avoid a larger surgery in future. So when you inject the gas, the size of the gas bubble has to be larger than the largest break. And these are the particulars. You can inject the SF6 gas or a C3F8 gas. The SF6 gas and the C3F8 gas in this particular case has to be a pure SF6 and a pure C3F8 gas. You can use either of them. SF6 expands 2.5 times. It lasts for 7 days. And it can be injected roughly in a quantity of about 0.6 ml. C3F8 expands 4 times its capacity. And it lasts longer, so 6 to 8 weeks. And you can inject about 0.3 ml. You can have complications during these procedures, like if you are injecting a gas and it goes only in the anterior hyoid space, you will have a sausage-shaped air bubble, which denotes that it is only the gas is trapped in the anterior hyoid. But after some hours or maybe a day, it can enter the vitreous cavity and then push on the particular retinal break. There can be vitreous traction, which can cause a break in the opposite quadrant of the retina. You can have fish eggs. That means when you are injecting, it has to be a smooth injection. If you are too hesitant, not sure about how much force to use, you can break that gas which is entering into very small bubbles, and then the purpose is not solved. When you do this, it is very important to tell the patient what position he has to lie in, because all these gases have buoyancy, they float up. So you have to give a position to the patient in such a way that the break is at the highest point. If they don't do it, the gas is not going to float up in a particular direction and plug the break, because positioning is very, very important in pneumatic retinopexy and calling the patient for follow-ups to see what is exactly happening. So this was about, in short, about pneumatic retinopexy. Let's go on to scleral buckling. Scleral buckles are in form of silicone tires or bands or sponges. Now most of us use silicone tires or bands. There are very few surgeons who are using sponges. The band, commonly used band, is a 240 belt buckle. The buckles are divided into symmetric and asymmetric. If you see the picture over here, you can see that the groove on this tire of silicone polymer is present on one side. So this is an asymmetric buckle. If you see the groove on the scleral buckle, it is bang in the center. So this is a symmetric buckle. Usually asymmetric buckles are used to give more indentation on the sclera. Symmetric buckles are used to give lesser indentation. So it is a surgeon's choice what they want to use. This is a photo depicting sponges, how the sponges are placed with the help of intermittent sutures. So this is a radial sponge because it is oriented perpendicular to the limbus. This is a circumferential sponge because it is oriented parallel to the limbus. So again, one more photo depicting a radial sponge and a segmental circumferential sponge. These are supported with the use of scleral sutures. This is an example of a small silicone tire which is cut and placed, and it is supported by an encircling band which goes all around. So you can use an encircling band on top of a scleral buckle to fortify, to give additional push to the sclera to go inside and approximate on the retinal brick. So there are various this nomenclature. I think you should know what is a 276 scleral buckle and at least what is a 277 scleral buckle. An easy way to remember is an even number. In this case, is a asymmetric buckle. 277 is an odd number. It is a symmetrical buckle. These numbers which are depicted here, they show the 7 number which is there over here. It shows the size of the buckle. The 9 which is shown is in millimeters. It is, you have to mark 9 millimeters on the sclera, and your sutures are going to be passed at a distance of 9 millimeters to accommodate a 7 millimeter buckle. So that is what are denoted by that. The 2.5 is the size of the encircling band if you wish to put it. You may or may not wish to put it depending upon the CPRIT. So as you can see in this photo, a segmental buckle has been placed along with the encircling band. So the height of the buckle is pushing the sclera from outside in. The height of the buckle is what denotes the success of the surgery. It should not be having a more than required height or very shallow height. So how do you increase the height of the buckle? It is by taking more tighter sutures. If you take sutures which are more closer to each other, you can have a higher height of the buckle. If you use asymmetric buckles, or if there is a little bit of hypotony inside, obviously the sclera is going to collapse more inside, then you will have a bigger height of the buckle. And if you use a type 240 BB, also you can augment the height of the buckle. While putting a buckle, you have to examine the sclera properly and choose an area very wisely. There should be no thinning. There should be no anomalous vertex veins. And from inside, if there is a scapuloma from inside, you have to be wary, because in these conditions, you may have a large bleed or a scleral perforation also, which will hamper your view. So the principle is the scleral buckle should support all the edges of retinal breaks and associated areas of vitreoretinal traction. In general, the buckling effect should extend into the zone of vitreous base to eliminate the current and the future tractional forces. The case selection, as we told, has to be very important. Mostly phakic patients with clear media, a fresh RD, a subtotal RD, very well visualized breaks at the equator or more anteriorly, and they should be depressible and preferably one or two breaks and not more than that. So what are the steps? I'll show a video also, but just going to the steps. First, we are going to open the conjunctiva. We are going to tag the muscles, localize and mark the break with the help of an indirect ophthalmoscope. We are going to achieve the retinopexy by doing the cryotherapy if possible. Then we make the scleral tunnels in all other three quadrants. We pass the belt buckle around. We take the sutures. We drain the subretinal fluid if required. Then we place the scleral buckle, tighten up the suture, do an indirect ophthalmoscopy again to see if everything is okay. If required, then inject a small buckle or a small bubble of C3 fluid and then close the conjunctival. So conjunctival opening. Sumit, is the video running?
Yeah, its video is running clearly, sir.
Yeah, the conjunctival is opened. So you have to be very gentle when you are opening the conjunctival because it should close properly. Good dissection always helps in reducing the scarring. To separate the tendons nicely around the limbus. This is an old video. You can use scissors which are much smaller in today's time. The limbal parotomy is done, and also in between the vertical recti, you go inside and open up the tenon space for a good exposure of this scleral surface. So this is the muscle tagging. For muscle tagging, you are using a muscle hook with an eye. And once you have passed a thread below them, below the muscles, then you have to also dissect the tenons. You can use either a cotton bud or you can use forceps. Forceps does a much cleaner job than the cotton bud. This is the scleral tunnel for passing off the belt buckle. So you use a crescent knife and make two parallel grooves. The distance of an imaginary line which joins the two insertions of the recti, you take two widths of the crescent blade, and that is a point where you start making this groove. So you progress, you push ahead with your crescent knife, and then make a groove in all quadrants, or three quadrants if you are placing a SB in one of the remaining quadrant. This is how, this is a 240 belt buckle. You have to cut the anterior end of it as shown, which makes it easy to pass below the recti, as well as it helps in gripping the belt buckle. And also, you know, you have to look for any twisting of this belt buckle, because you don't want any area where the belt buckle has twisted on itself while you are passing it. So I am using a cow hitch knot to keep these two ends of the belt buckle together. You can use also a Watts-Case sleeve. So it just depends on how you are trained. So once you are done, then this is an external camera. You are using an indirect ophthalmoscope, and you are trying to locate the break. Refer your fundus diagram, mark it, and then cryo it. So as you can see, a cryo probe. So I've marked that area, and now we are passing the scleral sutures. So this is like a mattress suture, where the first dip you are taking close to the origin of the recti, and then you are going, you are measuring probably a 9 millimeter for a 277 buckle, and going parallel to the limbus now with the help of a bobbing technique, and then you are coming back to the front. So you complete that square. So below these two, will the scleral buckle is going to pass. And these are stay sutures. So now, before putting the buckle, we are doing a SRF drainage. So you have made a choroidal opening. You cut through the sclera. This is called a scleral cut through. And the choroidal knuckle has, you can see the brown area. And you can see the SRF coming out. And the end point of this SRF drainage is when the RP pigments are seen. So that is the point when you can know that you have drained out enough subretinal fluid. Once you have drained it out, then you place the buckle on top of it, and then the band is again passed over it, and the tension between the 240 band is finalized. So the site of drainage is preferred to be at the point where the SRF is highest, and preferably if you can drain, because there is a lot of logistic in it. It has to be very comfortable for the surgeon to drain in a sitting position. Usually the inferonasal quadrant is difficult. So prefer to drain in an area which is going to be covered later on by a scleral buckle. And also to drain in an area, more importantly, where there is highest amount of SRF. So you can drain more and more SRF. So this is what I was telling about cryotherapy. Initially, before Gonen's era, they used to use thermotherapy, but now we commonly use cryotherapy, which is nothing but ice crystal formation at minus 80 degrees, which causes thawing at the intracellular as well as the extracellular level. There is tissue death, and there is a sterile inflammatory reaction which is formed, and which leads to scarring between the RP and the neurosensory retina. So retinopexy is very important. If you don't achieve retinopexy, then the surgery is going to fail. Indications when you will drain the SRF: bullous detachments, inferior breaks, chronic detachments. It is going to be difficult. The subretinal fluid is going to be viscous, so it may drain very slowly. So you drain as much as possible. also very important in high myopic patients where you cannot expect the RP to take up the function. So these are few indications where SRF has to be SRF drainage has to be planned. There are various methods. You can use just a hypodermic needle to drain it, or you do the scleral cut down as shown in this diagram and as I showed you in the video. The endpoint, as I told you, is the RPE pigments which flush out. You can have complications like choroidal hemorrhage, ocular hypotony. There can be, you can have a iatrogenic break, the point where you are entering inside the eye cavity through the choroid. If you go too much inside, you can have actually a break in the retinal surface, which is overlying. You can have retinal incarcerations. If you are too enthusiastic in taking out a lot of subretinal fluid, the retina actually can come out and pop out of that choroidal knuckle. That is called as retinal incarceration, which also can lead to incomplete drainage. You can also have a vitreous prolapse through that. So these are the complications which you will have. Precautions, examine the fundus to make sure the fluid hasn't shifted. So in between all these steps, you have to keep doing a good indirect ophthalmoscopy. Try to drain in the bed of the scleral buckle, drain closer to horizontal muscles, avoid the vertex veins, and maintain the IOP during drainage. Avoid a very high IOP or a very low IOP. So these are some of the do's and don'ts during buckling. Indications when you will inject a C3F8 bubble. So you inject it after all this is done, just to augment your retinopexy. So when there are superior breaks, it is very important that the patient can maintain a sitting position, which is actually very simple. So in a superior break, you will err on side of injecting more often than not. If there is hypotony at the end of all this, by injecting gas, you can actually increase a bit of IOP. So that helps. If there are retinal folds which are on the buckle, then they can get ironed out if you are injecting C3F8 bubble. If there is fish mouthing means there is a large horseshoe tear and the indentation of your scleral buckle has actually caused shortening of the sclera, then the horseshoe tear can actually open up and there can be opening of that is called as a fish mouthing. So to plug it again, to push it back again, you use a C3F8 gas. Causes of buckle failure would be improper positioning of scleral buckle, improper cryo, you are doing the cryo on the wrong area, residual vitreous traction, you have missed a PVR and you have planned a buckle for that patient. There can be also late complications like infection or extrusion of the buckle. So enough about buckles, going to vitrectomy. With the modern vitrectomy, we are more and more doing more vitreous procedures because the machines have improved and we have been trained. Most of the centers are training more residents to do vitrectomies more than buckles. There are only few centers which are still doing buckles. So it's important to know about vitrectomy, which is the more commonly done procedure. The few steps remain the same where you are opening up the conjunctiva. If you are planning to put a belt buckle along with the vitrectomy, then you are going to muscle tag, make those tunnels, pass a BB, put an infusion cannula, and you make two more sclerotomies, one for the light pipe, one for the vitrectomy cutter. You do the core vitrectomy, that is the anterior vitrectomy, clear the vitreous around the sclerotomy ports, induce the PVD, try to do as much of vitreous base excision as much as possible. If there is PVR, do membrane peeling, cauterize all the retinal breaks which you have identified, because once the retina settles, you may miss the break because it looks exactly like the choroid below. The retinal color is, you may miss the breaks. So then you do a fluid gas exchange, endo laser or cryo, and then you put a tamponade in form of silicon oil or C3F8, and then the closure of the conjunctiva. To do this vitreous surgery, there has to be attachment to the microscope. So you have various systems like iBOS, you have biome, you have lenses which can stay on. So there are multiple viewing systems which are available. Most commonly used is a biome, which is a non-touch system. Whereas prisms or lenses which are used for surgery are contact systems. So we would prefer to have a non-contact systems. This is just a photo to depict that. So coming to vitrectomy, I've edited the video. We have already put a belt buckle and we are making a first port, first sclerotomy using a disposable trocar cannula system. So the black one was a trocar, the orange one is the cannula, which is gone inside. You have put an irrigation cannula inside. So when you are removing the vitreous, you have to ensure that the eye doesn't collapse. So the irrigating fluid is the one which passes through this irrigating port. You have to ensure that the infusion cannula is inside the vitreous cavity by using a light pipe and looking from outside. So the core vitrectomy has started. Most of these patients may have a posterior vitreous detachment which is already there. There you can see, though you can see a horseshoe tear below, you can also see one more secondary hole at the edge. So after finishing the core vitrectomy, I am doing the peripheral vitreous dissection. You can see very clearly the retinal break which is there, which is the primary break, a large horseshoe tear. In a pseudophakic patient, it is all the more important because the area of ora serrata is very easy to access. So you do a good vitreous base dissection, and as I told you, marking of retinal breaks with a cautery is very important so that you don't miss them. This is the fluid gas exchange. So all this while there was irrigating fluid occupying the cavity. Now you are trying to push the air inside and take out the fluid from vitreous cavity as well as the subretinal space. And with the pressure of this air which has gone inside, the retina is going to abut against the underlying choroid, and that is how you achieve a attached retina. More important is, now we have to see that these breaks won't open up again. So you do a retinopexy. So this is a cryotherapy which is done, where you can see clear whitening around the break. You can also do endolaser. So this is a probe which goes through the same port where the cutter went inside, and you do laser around those breaks. You can do a 360 degrees laser also, depending upon the surgeon's choice and the case. So one more case so that all the concepts are clear. Again, a three-port vitrectomy, one for the light pipe, one for the irrigation fluid, and one for the cutter. So this particular case I'm showing because this patient has a different kind of RD. He has got PVR changes, proliferative vitreo retinopathy, where the RD has been long-standing and there is puckering, shortening of the retinal surface because of deposits of RPE, inflammatory debris on the retina, where you can see those white colored lines, that is the area where PVR is there. So initial steps remain the same, where you do core vitrectomy and peripheral dissection. And so you're using max grip forceps to actually hold these membranes and peel them off. So I wanted to show you membrane peeling, how it is done. And it is very important in these cases of PVR associated RD. If you don't remove these membranes, then they are going to cause a recurrence of RD. So all these membranes have to be dissected out. Obviously, the basic principles of PVD induction, removing as much of vitreous as possible, identifying all the breaks, they remain the same. You can see that still the retina is quite stiff. It's not as mobile as the previous case. So you go close to the retinal surface, try to hold, try to see the margins where these potential membranes are hiding within the folds of the retina, and dissect them up. So once that is done, you again push the air inside, fluid gas exchange, push the air inside, take out the fluid from in front of the retina and from behind the retina both, using something which is called as a flute needle. So with a passive pressure differential, the fluid comes out and you see a attached retina, and now the tamponade, you are seeing the oil being injected inside. So PVR is proliferative vitreo retinopathy, commonly seen in regmatogenous RDs of long standing duration or with multiple lesions. So this is an updated classification of Retina Society. You can take a snapshot on your mobile if you're watching. It's divided into grade A, B, and C. A is very early PVR changes, just pigment clumps and vitreous haze. B is there is slight wrinkling of the inner retinal surface. There is a vessel tortuosity because of puckering which is seen. And C is divided into whether the PVR changes are in posterior of the retina or more towards the ora serrata, which is the anterior of the retina. Also, you can have subclassifications like depending upon number of clock hours, focal, diffuse, whether there are membranes only on top of the retina or also subretina. So this is so that there is a common system to classify pigmentogenous RD PVR changes all over the world. So this classification is important. These are few photographs of pre-operative and post-operative. As you can see, that there is a horseshoe tear associated with the lattice degeneration with the RD, and after vitrectomy, the retina is settled and the C3F8 gas bubble, as you can see over here, is now slowly getting reabsorbed. One more case where there was a PVR change in the periphery and oil was injected inside and we achieved the attached retina. Again, a montage photo of the previous case where there was puckering in the periphery and you get an attached retina after silicone oil removal also. So coming to vitreous substitute, so it may be an important short note for all of you. Intraocular gases, as we were speaking about C3F8, there are two options over here. We usually use expansile gases, but in a non-expansile mixture, C3F8 and SF6. Sometimes we use air also, mostly only for vitreous hemorrhages, not for RDs. All these gases have common property, like they are clear, inert, low viscosity, slowly absorbed, and they have high buoyancy. The dynamic properties are with C3F8 and SF6, where once they are injected inside, the O2, CO2, and the nitrogen from the blood, they diffuse inside the gas, and there is a pressure differential or a concentration differential between the vitreous cavity and the blood flow which is there through the retina and the choroid. The aqueous which is secreted, the O2 and the CO2 get mixed in it, but the nitrogen slowly diffuses back into the blood. So the rate at which the nitrogen leaves the gas bubble, that is the rate at which the C3F8 gas is going to contract, is going to reduce in size. And usually that is about a month. In SF6, it's faster, it is about 2 or 3 weeks. So,
excuse me, Swapnil sir, it's 850 at present.
Yeah. So post-op care, in these particular cases, we have to do a good positioning of the patient and a head down position, because there is buoyancy of oil as well as gas has to be brought into play. So a head down positioning for 14 hours a day for 14 days is very important. These are few properties of C3F8 and SF6. We quickly rush through them. I've already spoken about it. Silicone oil, the commonest compound which is used is polydimethyl silicoxane. It is available in various strengths, and the strength is available as centistrokes. So from 1000 centistrokes to up to 5 or 10,000 centistrokes of silicone oil is available. I'll come to that. It is used mostly in cases where you require prolonged tamponade, where you want homeostasis, and it is also used as a space filler. Complications you can have is emulsification, that means that it turns turbid. There can be oil droplets coming in the anterior chamber and they float up. You can see as it has inverse hypopyon or hyperleon. And also there is a more tendency for oil to cause uncontrolled glaucoma or induce cataract changes in the lens if the patient was faking. Silicone oil always requires a second surgery, which is silicone removal surgery. So viscosity, as I told you, higher viscosity, it is more difficult to inject, but it emulsifies much later. And the advantage with silicone oil usage is if the patient wants to air travel immediately, then oil is a better option because C3F8 gases expand when there is a change of altitude. In a one-eyed patient or if there is complex retinal detachment with severe PVR, oil is the tamponade of choice. PFCL is also one of the liquids which is used mostly in cases where the retina is bouncing too much. It is coming too much into the vitreous port, vitreous cutter port. So this is one of the examples where the vitreous vitrectomy is over but the retina is getting engaged in the sclerotomy. So the liquid which was injected inside is a heavy liquid called as PFCL. It acts as a third hand. It pushes the retina down and allows the surgeon to have a safe dissection and the safe procedures in the front part of the retina. Because if the retina keeps bouncing up, then you may catch it in the cutter port and you may have iatrogenic breaks. So the recent trends are very promising. We are now moving towards 25 and 27 gauge vitrectomies. The viewing systems have improved. The endolaser probes are used to be only unidirectional. Now we have probes which have a bent tip, so we can access even the deepest crevices of the vitreous cavity to do endolaser. The oil quality is constantly improving. We can do a four-port vitrectomy also in complex cases where you introduce extra illumination source called as chandelier. And so you can have two working hands, two active hands, instead of one hand holding just the light pipe. There is also a newer group of surgeons doing endoscopy-assisted vitrectomies where you have opaque corneas or opaque lens area or the iris has been damaged. A very limited group of surgeons are doing for a very limited cases. The scleral buckling also has improved. We are moving towards sutureless scleral buckles. We are moving towards microscope-assisted scleral buckling. And the latest is the 3D vitrectomy systems where we no longer need the microscope. We are sitting erect and looking at a TV and then operating. Thank you very much. I hope I tried to cover all the aspects of retinal detachment as much as I can. Thank you.
Very nice presentation, sir, but there are multiple questions over here.
AK sir, you can unmute him. Somebody has asked exceptions to Lenkov's rule. Exceptions to Lenkov's rule would be EVR changes, would be RDs with multiple lesions. So this is what comes to my mind. Also, exudative RDs and tractional RDs do not follow the Lenkov's rule. It's for a retinatogenous RD with one or two breaks. So it is just to find a primary break. Where is heavy density silicone oil used? So heavy density silicone oil is used where you have recurrent retinal detachments and you want to keep the tamponade for a longer time, maybe a one-eyed patient. You want the oil not to emulsify too soon. So that is where you use Denziron, which is the heavy density oil. How much duration do we do silicone oil removal? Usually it is 3 months after your primary surgery. There are many permutations, combinations to it. If the patient has attached retina, but the IOP is under control, there is no cataract formation, you need not rush for the silicone oil removal. You can safely remove it after 3 or 4 months. If we remove the silicone oil too early, then there is a chance that there can be a recurrence. The retinopexy may not be that strong or the tractional forces may not have been negated fully. So early removal like a 4 week or a 6 week removal is usually not recommended. And in one-eyed patients, we can stretch it as late as possible. Why does the eyeball not collapse after SOR surgery? So once we do SOR surgery, we are not going to leave the eyeball with only ringer lactate or BSS or whatever we are using. We usually use an air tamponade or a C3FA tamponade. So air tamponade will stay inside the eye for say about 7 days, the C3FA tamponade will stay for 3 or 4 weeks, and then the aqueous which is there, it will somehow find its way through the zonules into the vitreous cavity, and the aqueous is going to fill up the vitreous cavity and it will take its place, and that is why the eyeball doesn't collapse after silicone oil removal surgery. Pritam sir has joined.
Yeah, I think, you know, this is a really vast topic, retinal detachment. And Swapnesh, you've done a fantastic job in covering this topic. I would like just like to acknowledge that, you know, two of the greatest teachers I've known, Dr. K.K. Mehta sir and Dr. Neeta Shanbag, have also are a part, and they have also joined today's seminar. So welcome, K.K. Mehta sir. You know, so for some of you who don't know, Dr. K.K. Mehta himself is a fantastic retinal surgeon. How are you, sir?
I am fine. Thank you so much. Give me a chance to revise everything. Thank you.
Nice to see you. So there will be a lot of questions. I think there was one more question about the refractive effect of scleral buckle on the eye. So, Swapnesh, you want to take that?
Yeah. So it usually would cause. It depends on the buckle height, obviously, but usually there will be a change of refraction, definitely. And the high, it induces lengthening of the eyeball. So you may have a myopic shift to your refraction. But it depends on the preoperative refraction. Also, it depends on a lot of other factors. Sometimes you have shortening. If your buckle height is too much, then you may have a little bit shortening. Or there may not be any change of refraction at all. It depends on how much tight the buckle is.
Right. There's one more question on... approach of subretinal fluid drainage. So, you know, to answer that, you know, not every time you have to drain the SRFs, subretinal fluid. If you're doing a scleral buckle, sometimes you may not have a very bullous retinal detachment. Once you have tightened your buckle, and if you're convinced, when you look inside, you're convinced that there is a good retinochoroidal apposition, then you need not drain the fluid, because once the break is closed, the retinal pigment epithelium, which is essentially a pump, it is going to absorb the rest of the fluid. So this is called as a non-drainage scleral buckle procedure. Whereas if your retinal detachment is bullous, that means after applying and tightening the buckle, you know that there is still fluid overlying, which is surrounding the retinal break, then you drain in those particular cases. And the techniques of drainage, there is something called as a needle drainage, which a lot of us, we were taught to do the needle drainage in Shankar Netralay. I know in LV Prasad, they follow what is called as a straight needle drainage, where under the indirect ophthalmoscope, they insert a straight needle in the subretinal space and then they allow the drainage. So these are some of the drainage techniques for scleral buckle. If you're doing a vitrectomy, then you have to do what is called as an endo drainage. That means from inside the vitreous cavity by using a flute needle, you allow the air, when you're doing fluid air exchange, you allow the air to go come into the vitreous cavity from top to bottom. And as the air is filling the vitreous cavity, you use that moment to drain the fluid from the retinal break. So the fluid is draining from the retinal break while the air is replacing the vitreous cavity. And then after that, the air is replaced by the desired tamponade, either by gas or silicone oil. So these are the various techniques of doing subretinal fluid drainage.
So there is one more question. The question is like this. Does the density of the silicone oil control the duration of the time the oil can stay inside the vitreous cavity? That is one. And there is also a sub-question attached to it. Does the higher density of the silicone oil can change the quantum of the correction required? This is basically... like for the cataract surgery that we do in cases of silicone oil filled eyes, so for the IOL calculation purpose.
Yeah, so see the density of silicone oil, why we choose a particular density of silicone oil. Now, you know, there are sometimes cases with very severe PDR, or, you know, you have contracted retina where, you know, you've seen intrinsic contraction in the retina. There you would want to have a higher density of silicone oil. There are certain silicone oils which are heavy silicone oils. So you might be having a higher density silicone oil, but which may not be heavier. So heavy silicone oil will tamponade the most inferior break at 6 o'clock. So the choice to choose a particular silicone oil depends upon whether you have 6 o'clock breaks, whether you have intrinsic contracted retina, whether you have a severe PDR. In such situations, you would use a heavy silicone oil or a denser silicone oil. As far as removal is concerned, removal is also the lower density silicon oils are known to emulsify earlier as compared to heavy silicon oils. So that is also, that will also to some extent, you know, heavy silicon oils you can keep for a longer amount of time. Sapnesh, you want to add to that?
Actually, we already answered that question previously. It was a repeated question.
Okay.
So, nothing to add, sir.
Okay, there is one more. The IOP is normal and the patient is pseudophakic and no other side effects of oil and retina is attached. Still, do we have to remove the silicone oil after 3 months?
Yes, finally, we have to remove the silicone oil. We can't just keep, unless it is a one-eyed patient, I will delay it for up to 6 or 7 months, provided it is clear, there is no IOP which is there and no, there are no other side effects. But you can't leave the oil forever and ever in a patient where other parameters are absolutely okay.
Okay. And sir, in the advanced vitrectomy technique, what is it exactly, the active fluid drainage in the vitrectomy machines? Do we actually use it in cases if there is a SRF is larger as compared to the rest of the RD?
Yeah, so it's not needed that you use an active fluid drainage. If there is an extrusion needle, extrusion mode, which is there on some machines. So flute needle is the traditional and it still holds true that you can use the flute needle to drain it. But if you want to do a faster procedure or if there is a thick SRF which is there, then you can use an extrusion mode. You can actually connect the front end of the flute needle to your extrusion cannula or the extrusion tubing, and you can use that to drain it. But it's not a must. It's not a must. You can do all the cases with the flute needle also, only that it will take more time, more patience. You have to see, in while drainage, the break has to be at the most dependent position. While doing the laser, the area of laser has to be at the most non-dependent position. So when you are using any form of drainage, you have to rotate the globe in such a way that all the subretinal fluid seeps down to the most to the area where the gravity is acting maximum, and then you will be able to drain the subretinal fluid. And when you are doing a laser, you want the fluid to get away from the space between the retina and the RP. So you try to laser and rotate the globe as much as possible in a non-dependent position where the SRF will be pushed, if at all it is there, in away from the brain.
There's another question. Someone is asking that when you're doing cryo, whether you should cryo only the choroid and the RP, or you should cryo the retina as well.
Usually cryo is only to the breaks, because it's a procedure which induces a lot of inflammation and a lot of post-operative swelling, lid edema also. Okay. So,
no, I think this question is, what they mean to ask is, when you're cryoing in a retinal detachment, on a detached retina, when you're cryoing from outside, how much should you cryo? Whether you should see just the choroid freezing or whether you should see the entire retina freezing?
If you have a color change of the choroid to orange hue, or if you see a little bit of thawing on the retinal surface, if you allow the retinal surface to become totally white, then the scar will be much more denser and then the post-operative inflammation, everything will be more.
So the concept is you're creating a sterile choroiditis, and that sterile choroiditis is going to cause retinochoroidal adhesion. So technically speaking, you only have to create choroidal inflammation. That is sufficient. Once you see the orange glow of the choroid, that is sufficient. But what happens at times is your RD is so bullous that sometimes you're using the cryo itself to, you know, you're not sure whether you've cryoed exactly corresponding to the retinal break. So you tend to cryo a little more to see that little reaction on the retina next to the break. That tells you that your position of cryo is correct. So sometimes for your good judgment, you tend to sort of cryo a little more till the retina becomes white and you're sure that you have cryoed all around the break. But the ideal thing is only to get a good choroidal glow, cryo the choroid and the RP, not the neuro retina.
And sir, what is the, we know post silicon oil, there are many chances of developing a secondary glaucoma. So what would be the best way to measure intraocular pressure in such case? It will be applanation tonometry, digital, or eye care tonometer, or whichever different are available today.
Well, the best way, yeah, Sapnesh, go ahead.
Applanation.
Huh?
Applanation tonometry is still the gold standard. In the simple way, that's the answer.
Okay.
More important is the Bonio. You can ask yourself to the Bonio or ask the consultant to do a Bonio, because there might be trapped emulsified silicon or oil bubbles which you have not removed. Till the IOP going up, there might be some Sinike or some trapped oil bubbles inside, which I would definitely pass on the management to the glaucoma consultant.
There was one question about how large width of the scleral buckle. You know, yeah. So the width of the scleral buckle depends upon, I wrote in the chat, it depends upon how posterior the break is. So, and normally the rule of thumb is that you should have at least 2 millimeters on either side and posterior to the break. So for example, what I follow is, suppose if the break, you have localized the break to about 5 millimeters from the ora serrata, then you add 2 millimeters. So your buckle should be at least of 7 millimeter width. So that is a rule which we use. If you are, so now, and then these numbers 276, 279, these are essentially code numbers given to these scleral tires or scleral buckle. And they are, depending on the width of the buckle, there are different. So 276 scleral buckle is about 7 millimeters in width. 279 is 9 millimeters. 280 is 10 millimeters. So these are only code numbers which are given depending upon the width of the buckle.
The buckle should support the posterior most margin of the posterior most break.
Correct. So good. So shall we conclude here, Sumit?
Yes, sir. I think most of the questions have been answered over here. And one question I just wanted to ask, sir, which they generally ask in this MS and the DNP Vivas, that what are the advantages of this newer advanced vitrectomy with the smaller and smaller port are available? What are basically theoretical advantages of this? That's what the examiners ask in most of the exams nowadays.
So should I answer and then you add on whatever I miss?
Yeah, sure.
So with propar cannula systems, the entry and the exit, the sclerotomy sizes have reduced. So initially we used to have a 20 gauge cannula which had to be sutured. So now they are disposable. First thing, that they are disposable, so that improves the speed, improves the sterility, and even post-operative inflammations around the sclerotomy sites are very minimal. So that is about the ports. More and more we are moving towards 25 and 27 gauge, even those things are getting better. The second is the cutters. Now newer cutters are available with the cutter mouth more closer to the tip of the cutter. So you can use the cutter like a multifunctional device. You can use the cutter itself to hold on to some membranes, cutter itself as a flute needle. So the cutter port has become a multifunctional because the port size has been optimized. Even the cutting rate has improved. The duty cycles, just like echo machines, have improved dynamics. Even the vitrectomy machines have improved dynamics to maintain the IOP. There is also an option that if there is a bleeder, then there is an immediate foot switch to increase the IOP for a minute or 40 seconds, where you can control the bleeder immediately. The endo cauteries have improved. We have got disposable endo cauteries. The endo lasers are now with a bent tip. So you can access, you don't need to change hands. You can access all parts of, whether you are right-handed or left-handed. You can use endo laser probes, which are very good. Then I also mentioned about endoscopic vitrectomies, which is used if the anterior part of the eye does not allow a good view of the vitreous cavity. Anything else, sir, what comes to your mind?
I think you've covered most of the things. So the two biggest advancements in vitrectomy have been the speed of the cutters, because the speed has increased. You know, we used to have only about 500 and 800 cuts. Now it has gone to 10,000 cuts. So vitrectomy has become faster. The vitrectomy gauge has become smaller, so you can do sutureless vitrectomies. But mind you, having said that, suppose if you're putting oil being, since it floats, sometimes oil in spite of your 23 gauge or 25 gauge can sometimes come out into the subconjunctival space. So many a times if you're putting oil, you have to check. If the oil is leaking, it is always better to take one suture rather than be sorry. You might end up with subconjunctival cysts because of the silicone oil. So the cutters have become smaller, so it has made vitrectomy sutureless. But one most important technical aspect that sutureless vitrectomy has added is, if you see, the sutureless vitrectomy uses what is called as a trocar cannula system. Now, in the past, we used to have, when we did 20 gauge vitrectomy, we used to do bare sclerotomies. So the bare sclerotomies was just a jab on the sclera. What used to happen was there was something called as sclerotomy related complications. So in sclerotomy related complications, while your vitrectomy was going on, unknowingly, some vitreous used to start coming into the sclerotomy port. And after the vitreous, even the retina used to start prolapsing from the sclerotomy port. Now, this would cause retinal breaks, iatrogenic retinal breaks, multiple iatrogenic retinal breaks. Now, what happens in the trocar cannula system is the cannula, which is essentially inside the globe, from the sclerotomy inside the globe, it traverses the vitreous base through and through. So when you start the vitrectomy, you know, you are already inside the vitreous cavity, beyond the vitreous base with your cannula. So there is a lesser chance of vitreous and retina prolapsing through that cannula, which is anyway, your vitrectomy cutter is snugly fitting through that cannula. So that has brought down the sclerotomy related complications because of this MIVS system. Am I right, Swapni?
Yes, yes. So KK sir is asking one question.
Yes.
About ultrasonic vitrectomy. I think Dr. Agarwal had used it for some time. So what is that about?
Yes, so there are ultrasonic cutters, sir, which are using ultrasound energy essentially. So what it does is the ultrasound energy, the concept is that it unlocks the collagen fibers in the vitreous. The vitreous is made up of a collagen mesh. So once these collagen fibers are unlocked, the vitreous becomes more fluid, liquid, and then the cutter sucks it. So it's based on the concept of unlocking the collagen, like a collagen matrix, unlocking it, making the vitreous more liquid and sucking it. And you know, it is thought that the kind of duty cycle these ultrasound cutters have is much higher. That means it can go up to 50,000 cuts per minute, that kind of a duty cycle. But the only problem, sir, what they are facing is, you know, the since they have to be small gauge, they have to be 23, 25 gauge, the time they are taking to achieve the, you know, the liquefaction is taking a little longer. So that is a problem. The timing of vitrectomy seems to have gone up with ultrasonic cutters, you know, the people who are using it. That is what their experience is.
In general, once the cut rate increases beyond 5,000, 7, 8, 10,000, our speed of vitrectomy starts reducing. In general, am I right, sir?
Yeah, that is true. But here, the ultrasound cutter force has to unlock the collagen matrix.
Yeah, collagen 2 is the primary component of vitreous, which they try to liquefy.
Yeah.
But in RDs, usually it is a liquefied vitreous. So if an old patient with a pseudopicic age group.
Yeah.
So it is.
Probably in younger patients, it will take longer time. In elderly, it will take less time. Okay. So shall we conclude?
Yes, sir. Yes.
Thank you. Thank you, everyone. Thank you, sir. Thank you very much. Swapnesh, that was a fantastic presentation. You've dealt with a complex and a large topic in an optimum amount of time.
Thank you.
Thank you, Sumit. And thank you, everyone. Good night.
Tomorrow
8 o'clock again, we'll have a lecture at the same time. If there is any change in username or password, I will.
Mostly the topic is ARMD. It will be presented by Dr. Chinmay Nakwa. Dr. Saroj is going to moderate it.
Fantastic.
Tomorrow there's also a webinar.
Yes.
BOA webinar. And it's a good, interesting topic, maybe for the postgrads also. Approach to a case of optic disc edema, you know, so probably, you know, even the postgraduates might be interested. Just everyone, make sure that everyone writes their names, because, you know, because of the security concerns on Zoom, we are allowing people into the waiting room and then into the actual meeting room.
We have a neurologist also tomorrow coming in from Jasco. along with the eminent ophthalmologist who are going to present.
Yes. So our that will start at 6 p.m., right?
Yes. Yeah. Thank you, sir.
Okay.
Hello. Bye-bye, and thank you so much.
Bye. Bye. Bye.